This is the MC Reggie Fresh Morning Show. A station that pays.
This is MC Reggie Fresh from the MC Reggie Fresh Morning Show. And folks, guess who's in the building? He was born in Lexington, Kentucky. He was raised in Jacksonville, Alabama. He graduated from Jacksonville High School. He's a retired veteran from the United States Army. He's a five-star dog breeder and the owner of Primetime Caney Corso Kennel. He's a proud member of Phi Beta Sigma and also a proud member of Prince Hall and a Prince Hall Mason. My Mason brother as well. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Mr. / Brother John Thomas Spaulding Jr.
This is the MC Reggie Fresh Morning Show. A station that pays.
Welcome to the MC Reggie Fresh Morning Show. What's going on, Brother John?
What's going on, my brother? What's going on, cuz?
Hey, man, ain't nothing to it but to do it, man. Trying to stay warm.
Yes, sir. This Arctic weather has got everything wrapped up, man. I would never think we'd get this cold here in Texas, bro.
Man, I'm trying to tell you, same way down here, bro. But you know, people need to be glad. Some people don't even got no power.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But anyway, man, we're going to jump right into it. First question I want to ask you, man, is how long you been breeding dogs and what made you want to breed dogs?
Well, I ain't going to say the dog game, but I've been, you know, been breeding dogs ever since I joined the service. So I was in the service over 20 years, bro.
Yes, sir.
And I started out with German Shepherds. Then I went to Rottweilers. And then I went from Rottweilers to XL Pit Bulls. And then from the XL Pit Bulls, I went to the Caney Corso.
Get out of here, man. Let me ask you something, man. So you wasn't never nervous? Because I'm going to tell you, man, I'm scared of dogs. I ain't, especially them big dogs you be breeding. Did you always like pets or, you know, and you wasn't scared of them? Or have you ever been scared of them?
No. I've never been scared of dogs, bro. I've been bit before.
Okay.
So, you know, as a child, I was bit, but, you know, I was the neighborhood, I ain't going to say dog catcher, but the dog saver, you know what I'm saying? So ever since I was a little child, man, I've always went and got the little dog that was a scavenger and tried to bring him home and, you know, feed him. So I've just always had a love for dogs. I can't say that too much about cats. I never had no cats in the house. My mama didn't like no cats. So I never, you know what I'm saying? I never had a cat, but, dogs. Yeah. Ever since I was a child.
Well, you know, man, I had my share of running from them jokers, boy. Man, you know, in my neighborhood back in Lebanon, Kentucky, man, you talking about running from dogs all the time. Like I say, we had a dog on the lane. It was a German Shepherd, man, called Brutus. Anytime Brutus was loose, everybody stays in the house. They don't move. Matter of fact, you know, sometimes, man, even though Brutus was a dog that everybody was scared of, we used to use him for an escape goat by saying, you know, if we want to stay out longer, you know, stay in the road in the neighborhood long, we'll call mama and say, Brutus is loose.
You can't get home, huh?
Yeah.
We can't go through that trail. Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know what you mean, but some of these dogs, man, some of these breeds will make you stop in your tracks for sure.
You already know. You already know. Now, man, like I said again, so you ain't scared of them and stuff like that. So again, now let me know what made you want to become a dog breeder.
I like I said, just the love, you know. Like I said, traveling throughout, you know, being in the service. I never could, honestly, Reggie, man, never settle down and do what I'm doing now. You know what I'm saying?
I got you.
I always had dogs, and so, man, I spend so much money on dogs in the military. It's a shame. But now, since I retired and whatnot, finally got the capability, you know what I'm saying, and the time to actually dedicate, you know what I'm saying, just to the dogs and have more than just, you know, one or two. So,
okay.
I mean it's always been a passion of mine.
Well, that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Plus, man, I know, how did you get trained, or did you train yourself? How did you get into, because I know you got to, when you do this kind of business, you got to know how to contain dogs and know what to do, know what to not do. So did you get any training from anybody, or you just, it was just natural to you?
Well, no, I can't say that. I mean, I would say natural, but at the same time, I've learned, you know what I'm saying, through all the different breeds that I've had. You know, I've learned and got, you know, knowledge from those people who I brought those particular breeds from. So, you know, it just added on to where I'm at right now. For example, you know, when I had one of my Rockwellers, I had a gentleman in Baltimore. I got the dog in Baltimore where I was stationed in Baltimore.
Right.
This gentleman was a retired Sergeant Major, and he had been breeding dogs for like 25, 26 years, man.
Wow.
Man.
Tight with him.
Hey, man, let me tell you something. He's really the one, like, when I saw what he was doing, you know, after he finished with the service, I'm like, man, I want to do this. I didn't know exactly what breed I was going to have, but Reggie, when I tell you, man, his name was Mr. Weems. Man, he had him and his son. He lived in Baltimore, and his son lived in Philadelphia.
Right.
He had 14 dogs in his kennel.
Get out of here.
His son had 13 in Philly. They was breeding German Rockwellers.
Man.
You know, people say it's no such thing, but German Rockwellers from Germany.
Mm.
Each year they would send four of their dogs to Germany to breed with the top stud dog in Germany.
Mm.
Now, I ain't afraid of no dog, but I'm hesitant.
Yeah.
Because when I pulled up to his kennel.
Yes, sir.
To see his dogs, he had one that was set aside off from the other ones, right? When
mm-hmm.
I pulled up in the yard, it was a big doghouse. And on the top, on the front of the doghouse, it said large. Large.
What?
When that dog came out, man, cuz, I'm telling you, I thought it was a black bear.
Get out of here.
I stepped back to the truck. Let me tell you something.
Yes, sir.
Step back, man, because I'm like, man, I ain't never seen no Rockweller this big.
Man.
That was a big black joker. Then I go to the back. I go to the back. The dogs are acting a donkey. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I ring the doorbell. Mr. Wings, oh, hold on. I'll come to the side of the house. He came out ready. Man, this man was so cold with it, bro. He walked outside on everything I love. He didn't say a word. He did some hand signals. He did his hands in there. Man, every last one of them dogs in that kennel sat down and shut up.
Didn't say nothing.
In a row. It did not say a word.
You lying.
I'm like, man, this is cold. This is cold. Mr. Weems was cold with it.
Get out of
like
here.
Like I said, the Rockwell I had that I got from him, he helped me train him. Reggie. I was in housing for 2 years. Government housing. You was prior military.
Yeah, I was. Yes, sir.
Sometimes you ride over to somebody's house, you knock on the door, acting crazy.
Yeah.
Bro, I'm in housing for 2 years. Nobody never know. My dog's name was Max.
Max.
He never barked ever. Ever. You hear me? Ever. for 2 years.
Man.
You could walk through my, when you walked through my door, to the right of you was a half bathroom.
Right.
He would sit in the, I would make him sit in that hallway. So he's laying in the hallway. You walk right past him. You're not looking to your left, right. You're coming down the hallway. When you come into the living room, Max knew he would come straight into the living room, bro, mm-hmm. and get between me and you automatically.
Wow.
And just look at you. And I would have to tell people, hey, don't make no move. Don't make no fault. You know what I'm saying? Because if you move, he going to move. And if you, and he going to be all over you. So, you know what I'm saying? Let me tell him to go back. All I had to do was pop my finger, snap my fingers, and say, Max, go watch the door. He would automatically go back and lay in between that space.
Wow.
And the bathroom, waiting on somebody to come in.
And a Rottweiler. Man, I had a bad experience with a Rottweiler myself, though. But, hey, you know, they look intimidating.
Yes, man. But Mr. Weems, like as he was asking me, yeah, he put me on a lot of game, man. He showed me a lot. He showed me a lot about the breed that I didn't know a lot about. You know what I'm saying? I knew about the Rottweiler. I do my research, but you know, with him having hands-on experience with those dogs for so long,
yeah,
I learned a lot, man. And so that just carried over to each breed I had after that.
Like, get out of here.
I had the XL pits, and then from there I went to the Caney Corso.
That was all right then, man. Now let me ask you this: give me one of your rememberable moments that you had as being a breeder. I know you probably got a lot of them, but give me one of the best ones. Give me one,
man,
of them.
Man, it's too many to name.
Because I know you can make people excited.
Yeah, man. I guess.
In a nutshell, then, you know, just making people happy with the dogs.
Yeah, that's what makes me feel good.
Okay,
you know
then.
You know what I'm saying? That I'm providing, you know, the families, you know what I'm saying? I call them part of my family because I just don't sell you a dog. When you get a dog from me, you like family.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I check up on the dog. I try to, you know what I'm saying? I'm calling. I want pictures to update my Instagram and all this and that. You know what I'm saying? I'm a phone call away. It's not just a money transaction for me because I treat every dog like it's my child, man.
Yes, sir.
I mean, when my puppies are born, bro, I don't sleep for 3 weeks.
Wow.
I don't sleep in my bed. I sleep downstairs near the weapon room on the couch to make sure that I don't lose a puppy.
Gotcha.
You understand me?
Yes, sir.
I don't lose a puppy. If a puppy dies, I'm depressed, bruh.
Yeah.
I mean, because I look at them like they didn't ask me. I created them. So every one of them means something to me.
That's all right, man.
So, it's too many. I just like to treat people the way I would want to be treated. And the joy for me is when I pass the dog off to the receiving family and the kids or the family is happy and smiling and they take pictures, man. I did my job, bro.
That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about, man. That's all right. That's outstanding. Now, brother Thompson, I want to ask you this, man. If anybody wants to be a breeder and they want to do that, no matter what type of dog that they breeding, but you know, it's still, you know, similar to what you're doing anyway, even if it's a different type of dog. Could you give them advice? You got any advice for them? I know everybody looks at it like they look at the money, which I know is good money, but it's a lot to come with it because I already know how that works because, like I say, I got a dog, and I'm telling you, just one is a lot of work. So do you got any advice out there for the upcoming new breeders out there?
Yeah, definitely, man. I mean, anybody who's thinking about it, first, know what you're getting into. You know what I'm saying? It's not a sprint. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know what I'm saying? It's a marathon, man.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Nothing's going to happen overnight.
Right.
So you got, you know, as that old saying go, you know how they used to say back at the crib, it's like Lotto. You got to be in it to win it.
You got to be in it to win it.
So, you know, you got to take the ups and the downs and you got to know that it's going to take some time. And I would tell anybody who's thinking about it, if you're going to do it, get you a mentor.
Right.
About that particular breed. Somebody's already been doing it that can guide you, tell you, you know what I'm saying? And when you have a pitfall or, you know, stumble upon something and you have a question, that you can deal with him. Like, for example, me, I have my mentor.
Right.
My breeder who I got my foundation stock from.
Right.
Anytime I call him, you know what I'm saying? Shout out to Chris Scott, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
He'll answer the phone, man. You know what I'm saying? He's never but a phone call away. So if I don't know something, even though I've done, and do your own research on the breed. Don't just get, oh, I like the way that dog look. Oh, he's big. He look, no. Please, I'm trying to tell you, know what you're getting into. You know what I'm saying? Every dog that I've named, that I've had, I'm a dominant person. So they not really for a person that's going to be not dominant. You got, you know what I'm saying? You got to show the dog that you the alpha male or you the alpha female. You know what I'm saying? If not, then they can rule over you. And you don't want a 100 plus pound dog ruling you.
Right.
Because now that dog ain't an asset. It's a liability.
Gotcha.
So it will and it can bite somebody.
You already
Every
know.
Every dog can and will bite somebody.
Yep.
If it's not trained and raised properly. So get you a mentor. Study the dog. Study the breed in which you want to get into. Also know that it's not going to be instantaneous. It takes time. You
yeah.
know what I'm saying? Definitely get you a good foundation of dogs if you're going to breed.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Meaning your stock, meaning your male and female that you get off the rip. Might have to pay to play. You're going to have to pay to get into it.
Plus, they got to have shots and stuff and all that.
Yes, if you can't afford the vet bills, then you definitely don't. Now, if you can't afford the vet bills on one dog, how can you afford the vet bills on 10?
Right. That's what I'm saying. Right. Okay.
And puppies. And, you know what I'm saying, and doing some stuff that a lot of breeders, and if you're serious about it, you do some of the things that, you know, I could tell you about, but, you know, if you're not, then you're doing what they call backyard breed. You're not doing the dogs in heat. You know, you just putting the dogs back there and you hoping that you get some puppies.
Yeah.
You know, I don't do that.
Right.
I take my dogs, I do progesterone tests, like a female, know when she's ovulating. You know what I'm saying? Know
yeah.
When it's the right time to breed her. You know what I'm saying? My dog's semen is analyzed and make sure everything is straight. I do everything. You know what I'm saying?
That's
I
what's up.
It. You know,
okay.
when it's time for me to have puppies, I have puppies.
That's what I'm talking about.
I'm guaranteed. If I catch the numbers right, the test doesn't lie. You know what I'm saying? When I do my TCIs and whatnot, I have babies.
Why? Wow.
Everybody's not doing it, but that costs money. That costs money. That costs time. You know, you can't shortcut, bro, if you're trying to win.
Gotcha.
If you're trying to put the best thing out there, you can't shortcut.
Now, let me ask you this. How many liters I know just a certain type of dog, like for yours, for instance, how many puppies can you have at one time? Are some people, when they breed, I mean, you can have...
Wow. That's a good question.
Yes, sir.
You know what I'm saying? The biggest litter I've had so far... My female had 14.
Wow. And what do the prices be like? Depending on the breed, but give me an example like for Cane Corso.
Okay, for the Cane Corso, for example, the average price of a Cane Corso is $1,500 to like $2,500.
Wow.
That's the average. Now, if you got dogs that come from overseas, such as mine, that came from Russia, came from the Ukraine, came from Romania, You got AKC grand champions. You got international champions. You got all this in the pedigree. Now you at the top tier. Plus my dogs are dual registered, meaning with the Cane Corso, you have the ICCF and then you have the AKC, which everybody should know a little bit about. That's the dog show that's shown during Thanksgiving. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
So the Cane Corso was introduced to the AKC. AKC accepted them back in 2010. So that's when they opened up the AKC to them. But the first founding registry for the Cane Corso when they came over in the 80s, late 80s, was the ICCF, the International Cane Corso Federation. So my dogs are dual registered, meaning
wow.
They got the foundation, meaning when they first came here, the ICCF, and they also have the AKC registry, which makes your dogs even more valuable.
Get out of here.
All my dogs are dual registered.
Okay.
So I can play in the ICCF side of the field, and I can play on the AKC side of the field.
Okay,
so
brother.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, no problem.
But what I was going to ask you now was, so when people wants to When you buy them and stuff like that, do you ship them out? Do they pay for shipping and handling, or does that all include?
No, sir. My price is not based on
separate.
The price does not include shipping.
Got
I
it.
Do have a shipper though that would bring your. He comes to my house, pick these puppies up at my door, and will bring the puppy straight to your door.
Get out of here.
You know, so it ain't no. You got. You know what I'm saying? You got. If you want to come get him, you can come get him, but. I have a shipper that'll bring the dog directly to you.
All right, now let me plug you in. I'm gonna plug you in, then, Brother John. I wanna know, how can people reach you if they wanna buy a puppy from you, if they want a little information about breeding, and how can they reach you and all that kind of good stuff? Your social media.
Definitely my social media. You can look at my page. I'm on Instagram at Primetime Caney Cane Corso, all one word. And that's PRIMETYMECANECORSO. Corso. Primetime Cane Corso, as we say, but it's pronounced Caney Corso.
Right.
All one word on Instagram.
And that's the name of the whole business?
Yes. Yes, sir. And if you want to reach out, you know what I'm saying, got any questions, you can text me, you know what I'm saying, or give me a call at... preferably text me, let me know what you're talking about at error code 904-537-1133.
All right,
or,
then.
Or you can hit me up on my Gmail at john.t.spalding@gmail.com.
Correct, man. Great. Now, brother, like I say, man, I'm glad you got on my show, brother. Appreciate it. And people, I want y'all to know, me and John, Brother John, we also got episodes every Friday called Real Talk Friday. Got to check us out. The next one will be, the first episode will be out in a few days, so y'all stay tuned for that. And you got any shout outs for anybody, my brother?
Definitely. Shouts out to all my affiliates that's part of the Primetime Kennel family. I got affiliates in Knoxville, my Primetime Kennel East family, Mr. Fame, my transporter, and the guys in Knoxville, Tennessee. I want to definitely give a shout out to my mentor and the guy that got me started with my foundation dogs, Chris Scott. Give a shout out to my family, you know, my wife, my kids, you know what I'm saying? Shout out to everybody that rocks with me.
That's what I'm talking about, brother. That's what I'm talking about.
If you want a good dog, you want some protection, you know, I don't need a gun. You know what I'm saying? I ain't going to do it. They're better than any gun you can get. You know what I'm saying? They love you. They're going to defend you. You know what I'm saying? And they always they're your best friend. So, but yeah, man.
That's what I'm talking about.
Red, I appreciate you, cuz. You know what I'm saying? For having me on your show. But I would just like to tell all the listeners of whatever... profitable business, no matter what type of dog breeding you into, just do your research. You know what I'm saying? And just know it's not a sprint, it's a marathon. But hey, it's good business. You know what I'm saying? Long as you doing good business.
Yes, sir.
You know, your product, let your product speak for itself.
You better believe it. You ain't got to say nothing, huh?
No, let the dogs talk for yourself. Just talk for themselves.
All right. All right, Brother John, man. Look, now I got one more question to ask you, man.
Yes, sir.
I want you to tell the whole world out there what's the baddest station in the land and the station that pays.
Sir, the MC Reggie Fresh Morning Show.
And there y'all have it, folks. He's coming to you from the Lone Star State, Universal, Texas. That was Brother John Thomas Spalding Jr. He was right here on the MC Reggie Fresh Morning Show.
This is the MC Reggie Fresh Morning Show, a station that pays.